Welcome to this edition of FICCI Fast Forward. All eyes are on Budget 2021, and who better than we have to share his vision of what the Finance Minister could do to address the Budget 2021. The Finance Minister has said that it will be a dream budget, maybe the budget of the best budget that India has ever had. And to share with him, share with us his views, we have Mr. Dinesh Kanabar, the founder of Dhruva Advisories. He is a reputed person in the whole tax area, having held many important positions in the past. So welcome, Mr. Kanabar, to this edition of FICCI Fast Forward. It's a pleasure to have you with us. If we can broadly just start with it, and you are very experienced and you are very knowledgeable about this, what are some of the key areas in the tax front that you feel that the finance minister should address in budget 2021, and that will actually improve the investment climate in India and also help us revive growth going forward and reach a higher growth rate in the year 21-22? Mr. Kanabar.
Dilip, as we look at the budget, and first let's go on to tax, and then we'll go on to some of the other economic themes. But let's first go to tax, and let's on tax look at some of the macro things which are required to be done. So the first thing is, we have had a year which has been a bad year, a washout year. The economy is slated to degrow. Whether the degrowth will be 7.5% or 10% remains to be seen. But clearly, it's a setback on the growth path that we were on. Now we are looking at the next year. And the expectation is, can we at least jump back to an 8% growth? Now, if indeed we have to grow on at 8% next year, so jump back from wherever to much what we were even before the COVID and whatever else, then what is it that will give impetus? And one important thing is going to be investment. And what is it that the government is doing to promote the investment climate? Very, very interesting, Dilip, while the government basically did away with most of the deductions and exemptions, in the last budget, the government introduced a very, almost at the last moment, a very subtle provision to say that if there is an investment by a sovereign wealth fund in infrastructure project, then the income from that, whether it is by way of interest, dividend, capital gains, will be tax-free. And in the process of talking about infrastructure, sovereign wealth funds, it also spoke about approved other investors. And the question is that if infrastructure is where a lot of money has to come in, a lot of money has to be deployed, can first of all the government come back and say that we are going to really permit all investment into this? Why? Whether it is made by a sovereign wealth fund or whether it is made by anybody else. So long as the project is an approved project by the government, all approved projects, any investment which comes in, income will be entitled to a tax exemption. If we do that, I would believe that the amount of money that we can attract into this one segment, which has a potential of creating jobs, potential of transforming the country, is of a very, very high order. So my first set of issues will be, what are you going to do to promote investment in the country? So this is one set of issues. The second thing is, how are we going to create jobs? People have lost jobs. People have suffered on account of lockdowns, et cetera, et cetera. And sure, while there is a bit of revival, the loss of jobs is a real thing. And again, the question is, can the government think back and reflect and say that, yes, if you are creating additional jobs, here are the breaks that we are willing to give you. So just two concessions that we are expecting from the government. One is on the investment on the infrastructure side. Other is for job creation. Sure, can the government do something more on R&D, etc.? Those are very, very good things to do. But I'm saying, if these two are big ticket items on which the government focuses, we should see some very positive movement there. The second set of things that I would look at is that COVID has impacted our lives in different ways, and what is the government doing on a tax front to mitigate it? Again, there are a number of suggestions which we have made as FICCI, whether it is that any amount spent by a corporation, by a taxpayer on anything related to COVID becomes fully tax deductible, is not subject to any limitations there. Very, very critical, will allow people to sort of be generous with the funds that they need to. There is still a huge amount of demand for funds that is to happen. Can we say that if any corporate, for example, provides vaccine free to their employees, any cost which is incurred is tax deductible? How do we make some of these issues such that the rigors of COVID are mitigated? Similarly, Dilip, one of the things which is very, very likely to happen is that organizations have suffered, have bled, and therefore there is going to be a lot of consolidation. Whether that consolidation is on account of M&A, acquisition, etc. And what is it that the government needs to do to make that happen? How is it that we ensure that our tax laws do not become a barrier to consolidation? Even today, while we have had some degree of liberalization, there are too many open issues. If you consolidate and that there is a change in shareholding, the losses lapse, not something which is acceptable. If you unless you are an industrial undertaking or a specified non-industrial undertaking, you cannot merge, the losses lapse. Can we do away with these artificial restrictions? And can we really permit any restructuring to happen, any consolidation, such that again, jobs are protected, people do not lose out, industries can come together, work together and survive together? So that is the other side of things. The third is the difficulties which people have been experiencing as a result of COVID. So there are delays in payment of interest. Can we say that those delays are not something which is going to be disallowed to you? Can we sort of similarly, there are so many items where there is a restriction on deduction for interest if you purchase a second house, etc. In fact, the minister has spoken to me repeatedly to say, should we remove this? Should we not remove this? And there are so many artificial of those restrictions, which maybe did make sense earlier, do not make a sense now. Similarly, prices of assets have crashed. And if the prices of assets have crashed today, and you go back and say, if a transaction is not done at a ready reckoner value or at a book value, I'm going to deem capital gains tax, or I'm going to be deeming income in the hands of the recipient on the basis of an artificial formula. I had multiple calls with Ministry of Finance where they have themselves come back to say, yes, we realize that these artificial provision section 50C, 56, etc., which put these artificial restrictions are not warranted at all. And what do we need to do to remove them? So again, the government would do very, very well to focus on that. And the last limb I would put really is that you need to promote ease of doing business. You are continuously talking about it, but are we really seeing it on the ground? So people are not making profits, but if you go to the tax office to get a lower withholding certificate, it is almost an impossibility to get it. Routinely, tax treaty benefits are denied. You end up ultimately, the Indian company ends up paying taxes. I remember at one of our interactions with the finance minister, I had raised this issue with her about refunds and said, no, we are giving refunds. But that is not the reality of the situation. You ask a corporate to get a refund, the officer has to approve. Then there is a IT cell in Ghaziabad that has to approve. Then it has to go to CPC in Bangalore that has to approve. And the amount of time that goes there is simply amazing. People are unable to get the monies that are legitimately due to them. How do we expand that entire process, make it very, very simple? So this is the broad theme that I would put, the four baskets: growth basket, job creation basket, removing issues which have arisen only as a result of COVID, permitting restructuring in a meaningful manner, which will allow companies to survive, and on ease of business. So one can again put number of things in these baskets. These are the four baskets I would talk to government about.
No, you know, just, you know, you've talked about your thing has been what industry wants. And there's a talk in the air that, you know, nobody will object at this point of time if government were to levy a COVID tax on select people. Now, how do you see the levy of a new tax or something like that to generate resources going forward?
I would make two comments there. I have heard about this. There is indeed one country which has done it, which is Argentina. So Argentina has levied sort of a COVID tax on rich people. But the point really, Dilip, is that we have a maximum rate of tax today for people who earn more than 5 crores at almost 42.9%, 43%. Now, what more are you going to do? Are you going to go back and say we are going to do 50%? And go back and reflect on this, Dilip. The government of Maharashtra reduced stamp duty to 2%, right? The collections have gone up many fold. Okay. I was at the registration office the other day. There was some transaction which I did. I managed to sell some property and the buyer had to go to register. It was so crowded that I was worried about getting impacted by COVID. I just signed and ran out of there. There is forgetting space to sit. There is no space to stand there. Now, you are... So the question is, do you want to levy more tax rate or you want to collect more taxes? And that is always a very difficult one. And, you know, if you go beyond 43%, I really think it would be regressive.
If you look at it there, and if you look at it, how do you know, how does government raise resources?
So when you speak of government raising resources, so what was the first point which I made? My first point was investment in infrastructure is the biggest need. It is the biggest job creator. It is the biggest infusion of funds and something which gives kickstart to the economy. Now, that's what is going to get you more funds. At the end of the day, you are going to get invest. Why did the government go out of its way to grant tax concession to sovereign wealth funds for investing in infrastructure? Because it believes that there's a huge amount of money sitting out there. The question is, how do you give impetus to the economy, which will give rise to the funds, as opposed to attacking the funds or taxes?
That's a very valid point there. But if I look at, you know, normally the budget is seen as a signaling device other than, you know, the tax related issues, right? So what is it that you would like to see, in the budget that will signal the government's intention to, you know, kickstart the economy and to revive the economy? Because one is survive, you know, and revive, right? But other is how do you make
right.
it? You talked about a growth rate of 8%, right? The World Bank today has come out with a figure of 5.2%. We don't, of course, believe it. We think it's going to be higher than that. But what could the government do in terms of non-tax measures and other things to?
So one of the most important initiatives which the government has discussed and which is a step absolutely in the right direction is to speak about Atmanirbhar Bharat. Now, you are also talking about trying to relocate manufacture from China to India. Two sides of the same coin. You are talking about being self-reliant. You are also talking about India becoming a global factory as a viable alternative to China. Now, first of all, Dilip, I have benefit of looking at factories in China. And when we say that we want to be an alternative, I don't know how many people even are able to relate. So I'll give some examples. So let's talk about an industry which India has now been able to sort of imbibe internally, which is manufacture of tiles, which you are now doing at Morbi. But a single tile manufacturing facility in China is of a size which is 3 times larger than the combined facility of manufacture of tiles in India. So we are looking at scale. We are looking, and if you are able to get that scale, your question to me, Dilip, is how do we signal kickstart of the economy and how do we get a comfort that we will grow 8%? The only way you will do that if there is investment in the public sector, in the private sector, the manufacturing actually moves, the Apples of the world and their contract manufacturers, the Foxconns of the world and whoever else are going to make huge amount of investments. The Intel is going to set up a factory here to manufacture chips, or whoever else is going to come here. Only then are we going to see growth of jobs and an investment. Without that, it's not going to happen. And therefore,
just to stop you here for a minute, but isn't the tax regime penalizing large companies? Because, you know, when the labor regime penalizing large companies while they said that, and what needs to be done there?
I was just coming to that. You're spot on. And so you spoke about tax regime, you spoke about labor regime, and the third is the land regime. And the question really is, can we go back and say, so we have spoken about this for eternity, a single point clearance. Is there a single point clearance at all in this country? Can you set up economic zones where manufacturing can come in and which is virtually a plug and play? That's how it happens in China. There is an infrastructure which is created. You want to set up a factory, employ 10,000 people, 50,000 people, whatever, and you set up, government will do whatever it is required to provide you the infrastructure. Your tax rate is a pre-agreed rate. There are no multiple assessments. There are no people coming and inspecting all the time. If you have transfer pricing, there is a pre-agreed transfer pricing mechanism. That is the way to go. That is the way to go. Dilip, might look like a digression, but it is not. I have seen a single factory in China employ 4 lakh workers at one place. A Foxconn factory in China, 4 lakh workers. I had gone down with the chief minister of Maharashtra, with Devendra Fadnavis when he was the chief minister. We took him to show what it means to build scale. There were 50,000 people there who were only manning the canteen.
Must be. So, but you know, if you look at it, so for the new manufacturing units and the greenfield units that are coming up, you have the reduced tax regime, right?
Absolutely.
But for existing units that you want to scale, isn't it a disadvantage? Should not something be done to enable them to actually go forward?
And the answer is yes and no. You are again talking about whether existing versus, I'm saying that if you expect that 15% is the right rate of tax, why do you want to have multiple? Today you have 3 rates of tax, 15% for a new company, 25% for an old company, and for an old company which wants tax exemption, 35%. You are simply creating a myriad regime. So I agree with you to say that, why can't you have a single rate? Why do you want companies to start restructuring? Put a simple rate of tax, but more important, Dilip, it's not about the rate of tax. It's about how the tax administration comes across. If you go to, and I won't go into the name, this is one of the largest global IT manufacturing and services company, one of the bluest of the blue chips. And we had a meeting with the PM, the global CEO, etc. And the point which was put was, we are not worried about the rate of tax in India. We are not even asking you to reduce. What we are saying is, when we come to you for assessment, don't artificially jack up our income by making disallowances which are not warranted. If you give me 15% rate of tax, let it be 15 on what I have earned and not have the officer go on making additions. That is what is ailing people.
So I think, you know, you've really spoken about a lot of things. You put your 4 buckets that were there. You've talked about the broader contours of the budget and also talked about how we need to attract scale. Is there any one last comment you would like to make in what, you know, you would like to see in the finance minister's budget?
You know, it's again about you were very right when you pointed out that budget is a signal. It's not really something which achieves anything itself. How can the finance minister really make this commitment to say we mean what we say and we will implement what we tell you? I think the ease of administration at the tax regime is the need of the hour. We don't need lower tax rate. How does she communicate accountability at the tax office to go back and say that, you know, what happened is when this faceless assessment was...
I was coming to that. When the faceless thing actually...
At that time, Dilip, a charter was put out, a taxpayer's charter. If you implement that taxpayer's charter, because it has been piece of paper, there is nothing which has happened there. A piece of paper just dangled and it's end of the matter. There is no breakup to say. So like, for example, one of the things in the charter is that there'll be accountability at the tax office. How will that accountability come up? How do I ensure that people are not raising frivolous demands? I think, you know, faceless assessment, Dilip, and this is a separate subject, I won't take a lot of your time here, is again a fabulous concept which is capable of being implemented so badly that it can go wrong. So one concept like that was dispute resolution panel, which was introduced 15 years back, has gone for a disaster. Faceless assessment implemented right can be a boon. From unfortunately what I see today, I'm not too sure whether it will be.
Thank you, Mr. Kanabar. Mean what you say and make sure it is implemented in a manner that is completely transparent and is, you know, understood by everybody. And automatically you will find investment coming in, you will find people complying with taxes. I think the underlying fact is that we need to have trust in each other and work in an area of trust. With trust and the government coming in, there's equal responsibility from the corporate sector to be responsible and, you know, actually support the government in their efforts. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Today. And we hope that a lot of what you say actually comes out in budget 2020.
I hope so too.
Thank you for your time.
Bye.